following program is brought to you with limited commercial interruption.
Today's broadcast is being simulcast in broken English.
Welcome to the show that we're doing right now.
What the hell are we doing on this show?
Boy, that escalated quickly. I mean, that really got out of hand fast.
It jumped up a notch.
It did, didn't it?
Let's go.
What is this?
Giggity, 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 goo.
Who else but
the Q?
It's showtime. Gentlemen, gentlemen, let's get down to business.
Can you dig it?
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Qnow. Now you're listening to the best pop culture, current events, current affairs show, east or west of that Mississippi River, hailing from the great city of St. Louis and worldwide at the Qnow.com. I am your host, Mark Bland, joined today by my co-host, Jason Cole. Up once again,
oh, here,
we always
I ran in.
Kill it. We always kill it.
That was
with
a long run.
That was a long
Jerry's
run.
Far away, and then I ran so fast to the microphone.
Very fast. And that other voice, ladies and gentlemen, joining us today is none other than our friend Jenna Roberson. Roberson. It doesn't matter anymore. It's Jenna Roberson.
Hello, thank you.
She is back to join us for these holiday hijinks, as I like to say. Fresh off of our Thanksgiving.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying?
I'm so full.
We are going to be doing the second round of the Biggest Jerks tournament.
Yeah.
That's coming up. But what a week, ladies and gentlemen. And by the way, to all of you out there at WIBH or KYRO, respectively, hello to all of you in Radioland, too. It's been a hell of a week, guys. Argentina elected an anti-socialist economist, Javier Milei.
You're like dancing. Yeah, look
in
like
a landslide.
It looked like a scene from
it's
Scarface.
It's crazy. It's crazy because it's these hard-line individuals.
Right? They're going to learn the hard way.
Getting these wins. You know?
And they're going to be like, wait a minute. This
like down
totally
in
sucks.
The guy down in Brazil.
Bolsonaro. Yeah.
Bolsonaro.
He lasted one term.
Bolsonaro, yeah. All, right. I'm just saying, like, when they get like, these Trump style dudes, just like Trump, one term out, gone. Like, you got to stay out. But at the same point, like, Geert Wilders and his party won a shocking landslide in the Netherlands. And Geert's a pretty hardline conservative.
Yeah,
like that is that's the kind of dude only a Michael Johnson, Mike Johnson,
Mikey as he's known.
Johnsonism. I like instead of McCarthyism, I like Johnsonisms.
Mikey, give me a towel.
Jesus, Jay. But yeah, a hell of a week. Also, a Republican mayor was elected in Charleston for the first time since 1877.
Been a while.
Been a while.
Sorry about that, folks.
So,
got distracted.
It's
go
just,
Cubs.
Exactly. But no, I find it just, it's kind of crazy that we just have so much of this rhetoric going around now.
Yeah, everyone's
this
mad.
Sentiment around the world. It's not just St. Louis. It's not just Missouri. It's not just the United States. It's not just North America. It's other countries and other continents where these individuals with this more dictatorial vibe to them are winning and people are getting behind them. Populists, technically. I mean, anybody who is popular could be a populist. So that's kind of an unfair statement. That's more of a broad brush people will glaze with on that one. But,
they're scary.
It is.
Like, if he gets back in and he would happen to have the House, which I don't think would happen, and the Senate, they would pass a bill to make it legal to kill protesters instantly.
Yeah, I know.
100%.
Absolutely.
There's no way
to kill protesters?
Yeah, if you're protesting. Because they already made it legal in some states to run you over. What's next? And he'd make it a federal law that you protest him, he'll shoot you.
Federal ban on abortion.
Right?
Federal ban on marriages.
Break up gay marriages. Schools, maybe.
Oh, yeah. Schools will be gone.
Not boy girl.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, let's get into topic one real quick. And by the way, today we are also, this has to be announced, we're going to be joined by John Kiehne, who is running up against Ann Wagner for her congressional seat in St. Louis. That's a big, big thing coming up here a little later on the show. Yes. We're going to be welcoming John, and we can't wait to talk to him and find out a little bit about what he wants to bring to the table. You know, that's why a guy like this comes on shows like this. They want to get the word out there. They want more people to find out about it. They're willing to put their message out there. So we're going to find out where Mr. Kiehne, right? Correct.
Correct. I'm excited. He's a wonderful man.
Seems like a nice guy. We've been talking behind the scenes, so I'm excited. Let me say him. And welcome, beautiful Saturday. Could be be early. It's just these days. I tell you, man,
go outside.
They go so fast in your life.
They really do.
They really do. Like, I was just sitting there thinking about it behind the microphone. I was just wondering, like, just the other day, where this time? It just comes and goes. Like, and I'm just like,
never
like,
stops.
Like, this is,
you're like, slow down.
Is it extra 4D or whatever? Yeah. Like, this is beyond 3D, right? Like, this is, and that's moving through the earth. And if we touch each other, I know that we've touched each other. Yeah. I can feel that, and they can feel mine. So it's like, okay, this is like how life is. Like, this is what it is. Like, walking in this slab of human, whatever this is. Kind of crazy, right?
Yeah. Think how cool death will be.
Oh, my God. Stop.
Think about it.
No. We're not thinking about that, ladies and gentlemen.
Die.
Donald Trump marks the holiday season with a deeply deranged and lengthy rant about how great his rallies are and how they're always sold out.
It matters.
A bizarre topic given the growing indictments against this man.
Obviously, there's votes there. If that was, it's always times a thousand. Let's go.
They're down to school gyms now. They can't possibly be that hard to fill.
How crazy is
this man's mind is clearly rotting away to nothing. In a Truth Social post, Trump said that many times he was making a speech which are always sold out so that lots of people can get into the venue. The fake news will see people come down from the rafters onto the floor just to get closer to the stage. As soon as this happens, the lamestream media starts taking pictures of these fully occupied areas and seats and then come out with a story. Trump Arena wasn't full or Trump didn't have a sellout.
Right, that's all that matters.
He went on.
That's what matters.
As usual, the man is driven by his own pathetic, fragile, shameless lying ego there, Jay. There have been countless occasions on which his crowds have been small, in large part because he has grown boring. All he does is ramble on about the big lie and wine these days. Trump went on to claim that thousands of people get sent away and the rallies never have empty seats because we're selling a product people want, American greatness. In reality, all he's selling are MAGA hats made in China. We all know this.
This is
a movement like none other, and the failing media should get on board now. The failing media.
Yeah, this guy's got some fines to pay. You buy some more hats.
He's right that there are no other American political movements like his right now.
Thank goodness.
Since his is an overtly...
You know what? There can only be one Hitler, but there definitely can be many Mussolini.
Oh, yeah.
Right? And he is a Mussolini. This guy
overtly
is
fascist
crazy.
One. Yes. Working Bombastic. To destroy American democracy.
Violence
exactly.
is cool.
Exactly. No. Yikes. Correct. Correct. The 2024 election will decide the future of this country, ladies and gentlemen. More specifically, if we have a future at all.
Right?
You know? Like, I'm not sure what we're looking at.
Right? Day two.
Listen, I wasn't born and put on this earth to sit here and feel like I should be scared to live a life.
I mean,
I just don't feel like it's necessary or a part of the game. Now, I know it's a part of the game.
Right.
Like, the reality is right there in my face every single time I walk around this earth.
Like, my mom never planned our route when we went to the grocery store.
Yeah.
Right?
It's just nuts.
Or like, there's the exit.
I mean, if it weren't for projection, they'd literally have nothing to say at all.
That's true. If these open admissions of guilt didn't drive them to speak, they wouldn't say anything. They'd just be like, what? I don't know.
Every time they say something, I'm like, this is a confession. Right? So when's the backstory going to come out?
Right? They're like, I can't believe the Democrats watch all this porn and masturbate all the time in this chamber.
Is the poorest example of a human being
Democrat
in all of history. He absolutely has no positive personality traits.
No.
None.
No.
Right. Absolutely none.
Come on, like they're cool with a congressman using campaign funds to subscribe to OnlyFans accounts. I mean, like
that's wild.
He was in the House.
Now listen,
like, probably masturbating. Why even have
now? Listen,
it?
OnlyFans listen, stuff. Listen. Hey, listen. If Donald Trump, legit, if Donald Trump was just an honestly decent politician. I'd have absolutely no problem with getting behind someone who likes to be a little tough at times. I don't mind that. That doesn't bother me in the least bit at all.
There's Democrats like that.
This is not that.
No, this is vile.
This is,
antagonistic.
It's the weaponization. This is weaponizing.
Yeah.
And using what can, like, he's openly admitting, like you said, directly to all microphones about the things that he is willing to do and thinks should be instituted.
Right.
To put fear into people's hearts, to make them feel a certain way. Like, and I'm not saying that it won't happen. I'm not going to say that it can't happen. That's not going to happen.
It could be. Look how many people he has.
It happened on January 6th already.
But he has believing that he is in the right because Democrats are prosecuting him for breaking the law, the real actual law. He's telling them, these guys are bad. That'd be like me like telling you this cop is bad for getting me going 70 in a 35. like he's so bad. Like, come on, everyone.
It's a witch hunt, 70,
that's what
35?
It is. Like, and everyone's like, yeah, what are you doing? He's driving. You know, it's like... And that's what he's doing. And the cop's like, he's going 70. What is wrong with you?
The speed limit.
Right? Like, you people are crazy. And they're like, yeah, whatever. You know, you hate America. And it's like, how does this happen? That's how it happens.
Mm-hmm.
referencing allegations this week, I wanted you guys to hear this. Trump said he was with four hookers. You think that was good to go up and tell my wife, it's not true, darling. I love you very much. It's not true. However, a number of social media commentators questioned why Trump has referred to four hookers as this figure isn't included in the Steele dossier. Like,
he's
things
like,
that he's always like denied and thrown around. You know what I'm
he's
saying?
He's bragging. Like, he can't
things,
help himself.
He's got to put it out there.
He's
like,
gotta brag.
Float.
He's like,
he's got to. Oh yeah, listen.
Right? Like, he probably gets off on getting
he
away
has
with
to be, when, he has to be worshipped.
When the Rudy Giuliani thing was going down,
poor guy.
Probably a couple of issues ago for Rudy,
right?
Trump was like rolling to his defense, and it looked horrible.
Yeah, he's like,
and
he's
then
fine.
He's
fine. It's like, what? Like, he was going to masturbate in the bedroom, like on camera, Mr. President. Fine. You're a terrible person. Like, what are you doing?
If you got to be talked into viewing
she
people.
She said she was 18.
Right?
This is, I mean, I'm serious, guys. I understand. Listen, I understand a section of our society wants there to be a little bit more of a rugged dad-like figure at the steering wheel. That's fine. And some dads are like Donald Trump. That's horrible. That is definitely something I would not want to be.
There's some kids looking for some love somewhere.
Now,
in all the wrong places.
I don't think that Donald Trump is Satan incarnate. I don't think that he's the devil himself.
If he started murdering people himself, then he would be the worst person ever.
But
right now, he's just real bad.
Right now, he's just saying a lot of there's a lot of bell whistling going on and saber rattling, as they like to say. Is that what the saber rattling?
Speaking of singing, did you hear that daughter-in-law of his belting out that Tom Petty tune.
I couldn't bring myself to listen to
That's
it.
That's awful.
I said it was did bad. Not so try bad. To listen to that. It's like, I don't know why you would put yourself in that position.
It's so
sir.
Bad. Because I had to hear it. I can't just tell her it's bad. That's, you know, and I never listened to it. That'd be bad, you know, for me. You know, and it was awful. Awful.
I believe it.
Oh, it's like, so bad. Oh. I mean, it's just, it sounds like what they would do for you. Remember back in like the 80s and 90s, you could make a song or a video at Six Flags?
I mean, what do you expect from someone who steals money from a kid's cancer?
Right. But, and so, you know, and that's what it is. It's just her singing. I don't even know if that's any different than the music, but it's bad and it's terrible. And she just sounds awful. It's just her voice is just so fake.
That's unfortunate. So embarrassingly unfortunate.
So this four hookers comment is it's like hookers. That three shot glass scene from the Inglorious Bastards movie.
Yeah, where he holds up the different
fingers. Except for it's hookers.
Yeah.
Instead of German porn, it's Russian. You know what I'm saying?
Like, four means something there. It's
there
different.
It is. It's just a little different. Like, I don't understand, guys.
Four
I
means
just...
pick me up in Iceland.
Listen, like I said, the dad type leader, I understand that
here.
Vibe. I understand that need for that. But if it's going to the point of being verbally and physically abusive in any form or fashion towards the people of this country, that will not be tolerated by the people of this country, I don't think.
If they finally turn, you know what? When everyone finally turns, all they have to do is pay attention. If like more than like two Secret Service agents' families all buy plane tickets to one place, get him because he's getting ready to run. Because that's what he paid off those guys, and they're taking their family and splitting with this lunatic because he's giving them X million that he doesn't have.
If you promise not to come back, go.
Wouldn't that be great?
At this point, just go.
Wouldn't that be amazing to get up in the morning and, like, the news is broken and it's Donald Trump is running out of the country or something? Wouldn't that just be fantastic?
I don't think it's better than OJ.
All right, you know what? Save that question, because when we come back here on the show, John Kiehne is going to be with us on the phones. He's calling in to hang out with me and Jenna and Jason, and we are going to talk to him about running for Congress and all the goods that go along with that. We will be back on the Qnow right after this. AM, 105.3 FM, KYRO, News Radio, KYRO.com, and WIBH. Welcome back to the Qnow. My name is Mark Land. That over there is Jenna Roberson. Roberson.
One day.
And that over there is Jason Kull.
Ooh, right on the nose for me.
Yeah, that's right.
Of course, he has favorites.
And ladies and gentlemen, getting ready to join us right now on the phone lines is U.S. congressional candidate John Kiehne. Welcome to the Qnow, Mr. Kiehne.
Hey, how you doing? Thanks for pronouncing my name correctly. That doesn't happen all the time.
Well, that is thanks to Jenna Roberson.
Look at that.
Thanks, Jenna. Thanks, Jenna. And thanks for the Michael Jackson intro.
Yeah.
That's a hit in our house, and it's a hit with the children in general.
Not a problem. We always aim to please when it comes to our special abilities with the music. I don't know what I like to call the minutiae, whatever that is.
Classic bass line, man.
You through music.
It is. And listen, you know, it's great that you brought that up right off the bat, because you yourself are a musician. And I was not aware of this. And I've worked in the music industry for a long time, but that doesn't mean I know everybody and everything. I was pleasantly surprised to find out a little bit about you. And is this like a lifelong passion, or is this a job for you? I'm not sure.
Well, that's a good question. You know, the funny thing is, you've been in the music industry for a while, so you understand that it can be very challenging, and it can be very rewarding. I, until a few years ago, was a professional musician. I taught, produced, play, perform, tour, whatever, for the better part of 40 years. So I started playing. I'm a fifth-generation Missouri native, which I never cared about until I got into politics. But grew up in St. Charles when it was kind of like out here, we're in
rural
Eureka, and we lived in Franklin. Yeah, man, it was like Sullivan or like St. Clair or something back when I was a kid. And we used to play, you know, like a biker bar in Winsdale when I was, you know, a kid. And, you know, St. Charles has changed a lot, but that's kind of where I started, was playing, you know, all the classics back in the late 70s, early 80s. And, yeah, I've spent my life either making a living doing that or trying to, up until a few years ago.
So where does this – let's just dive right into it. Where does this passion for the idea of politics now arise at this point in your life? Like, I feel like you've had a very successful and fun life up until this point. Not saying there wasn't hard work involved in every aspect of the things that you were a part of. But now there's a switch in the gears, right? Like, you've made this move to politics. Why the change? Where did this come from? Like, where does this start?
Family.
I did, and I think that we had a little conversation prior that you were kind of a hip hop fan. Was that kind of your
yes.
more your realm, doing stuff in hip hop?
Yes.
I would say that my musical influences have been a lot of R&B, a lot of funk, a lot of hip hop when hip hop became a thing. And I always liked artists who had a social, you know, sort of element to their songwriting. So, interestingly enough, a lot of people wouldn't think about it, but even Ozzy Osbourne, when I was a kid, who was, you know, biting the head off of bats or whatever, was, you know, some of his lyrics are amazingly political. And I would say that is part of my experience in sort of my interest in social issues, politics. And then, of course, I was very appreciative of a lot of black artists. And I played with a lot of black folks coming up in St. Louis, played a lot of R&B and funk. And, you know, going to Boston, I lived in Boston for 10 years, which is a very, I think why I landed there after touring all over the place, was it's a very cosmopolitan place. So, you know,
melting pot.
I would say from starting college at UMSL when I was a kid and, you know, experiencing a lot of different kinds of people than I was experiencing in St. Charles, and then going beyond that to touring around the country, to then moving to Boston, to now having a black wife and kids. But I'll have to tell you, you know, I love playing music. I always have. It's a great way to pay the bills. And yeah, we know it's challenging, but, you know, I'm not a famous rock star. I'm not Post Malone. You know, I'm not Nelly. I'm not Sammy Hagar. But nonetheless, I could pay my bills playing my guitar, and it's a pretty good deal. But in September of 2007, we had a kind of a family crisis roll up on us that we weren't expecting, and that really changed the whole rest of my life. And from that point, my wife and I became foster providers, and then we really dove headfirst into behavior health and social services, being foster parents, schools, so IEPs, the judicial system, law enforcement, healthcare, et cetera, et cetera. I got really frustrated as a provider and someone trying to protect and nurture victims of domestic violence and neglect with how difficult it was to try to get services and supports for these kids that have been through so much. And it's not just us, it's the system. After going to administrators, to supervisors, to this person, to that person, at some point I realized that policy was broken and that governance was very I said broken, for lack of a better term now, but at the time it's very inconsistent with, you know, how policy worked and how this person would get these services, et cetera, et cetera. And when Trump got elected, you know, kind of like, I have a black wife and black kids, and I have gay married cousins and just a wide variety of people in my life personally, I had to do something. And my intention was to knock a door or something for a Democratic candidate. Then I discovered out of the blue that we lived in the 3rd Congressional at the time. Number one, I'm not sure I even knew what congressional district I lived in until 2017. And I realized that there was really no one to knock a door for. And I kind of had this curtain lifted up where I realized that the Democratic Party in the state of Missouri is very weak and as just in the last number of years, been very challenged. And so I said, well, if we don't have a candidate, I guess I'll do it. And that was basically winter 2017, 2018. I've run three times for state legislative seats, and I'm now running for U.S. Congress in Missouri's 2nd Congressional District.
I'm curious. I'm curious. I've noticed throughout the interview, you've mentioned a few times the fact that your wife and your children are black. And I understand that that is important to you, obviously, as a father and a loving husband. As far as like the campaign goes, though, I'm curious, is there a reason why that you've mentioned it so much, or is it just one of those things that you're quite proud of? I'm just curious.
You know, it's a good question. I don't know. It's a matter of pride, per se. I wasn't looking for, you know, a black wife and black kids. It just kind of turned out that way.
Sure. No, understandable.
But, you know, I am a straight, white, healthy man. And all those distinctions have made, from my experience, my personal experience as a human being, in my life in this country, a little bit different than somebody who is not healthy, from someone who is not male, from someone who is not white, from someone who is not straight. And having that person be the person you share your life with and the children that you raise kind of really makes it impossible to not see that their experience is different, that they get pulled over when I don't, in the same car, in the same neighborhood, doing the same thing. You know,
that's
whatever
right.
the case
yeah,
may be. But, you know, really my entrance had nothing to do with that. My entrance just had to do with, you know, really the challenges that we had as foster providers, you know, which are you could go to the quote unquote CRT aspect of that in the establishment. And but it really affects poor people, not just black people, but
sure.
poor people and, you know, people of limited means. And that's really been my motivation. So we all need access to quality, affordable health care. Black, white, purple, green, gay, straight, you know, rich, poor. I've seen some very wealthy people who have had multiple houses, you know, an immense amount of wealth, have a health crisis that completely crashes the whole thing. And locally.
Wait till they're – listen, I'm not trying to throw conspiracy theory or this, that. We've talked on this show about the rhetoric going around the United States of America. Listen, let an actual civil war pop off. Let a few hundred thousand pop up on the registry at the same time and needing all the money to go to all the resources to all the people all the time at the same time. And I bet you immediately in the United States of America, the idea of universal health care immediately becomes the focus. Like, oh, yeah, we need it. Oh, we got to have it. Why? Because we had a war, and we got a lot of bills to pay, and none of us can afford any of this stuff. And it's like, you
crazy
didn't realize you weren't going
to
be able to afford war before it started?
Like,
but
no,
I'm just saying, like, I just find that interesting.
It's an interesting idea, but, you know, to that point, you know, I think about contrasts and rhetoric and what we hear on, let's say, right-wing news sources versus the middle versus I don't really listen to, quote-unquote, progressive stuff so much. I'm more interested in, like, raw news and what's happening without bias, if I can possibly get that.
You want that BBC is what you want. Yeah, I get it.
If I can. I hear a lot of right-wing folks and see a lot of right-wing folks that don't want to spend money on something over our borders, be it Israel, Ukraine, being in NATO, being in the UN. Da, 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 da. Why is our money going there? Why is our money going there? Why is our money going? Let's bring it home. But then when we have these investments in the state of Missouri, in our country, like the IIJA, the IRA, the CHIPS Act, et cetera, ARPA, all these funds that, you know, gave us a surplus in our state budget that allowed us to do these things that are investing our state in our infrastructure, in our broadband, fixing our roads, et cetera, et cetera. But every Republican congressman in this state rejected that funding except Blunt voted for infrastructure funding.
Correct.
He actually voted for that. Every other, and you know, he's not in Congress, he's not a senator anymore, but every other congressman in this state voted against that. While we see our governor, our Republican electeds celebrating these investments. So it's interesting that the sort of the rhetoric or the what I see from quote unquote more, you know, Republican right wing sorts of folks is they don't want to spend the money over there, but they don't want to spend the money either here.
And oh, so yeah. No. We're not going to do it.
We're socialists, communists, Marxists. I mean, you know, it's something different every cycle, but it's Marxists right now, you know? But yeah,
John,
if you look at how our ballot measures come about, people vote in favor of Medicaid expansion. They vote in favor of medical marijuana, recreational marijuana, raising the middle wage, the minimum wage. They vote in favor of, you know, not right to work, so opposing right to work. So they're voting in favor of a lot of workers' rights stuff. Arguably, workers' rights arose from the socialist movement or, you know, allied with the socialist movement 100 years ago in workers' rights. So there are a lot of kind of contrasting issues with how we look at policy and how I think there's a disconnect from your average voter and the reality of what's happening in our government.
That is an interesting, I wanted to ask you something. I don't think I'm going to have enough time in this segment. You know what I'm saying? And in the next segment, I wanted to do something with the hot seat. We have this thing called the hot seat. And when somebody comes on our show for the first time, we like to put them on the hot seat.
We're
basically, we ask you some questions. These are questions you didn't know about. We weren't
nice.
Bringing them to the table. At the same point, they're nothing that's going to hurt you in one way or the other.
Right.
This is not anything politically angled or anything like that.
We can
so
say
you
nice
have
things.
Nothing to worry about either. You just have to answer the questions, you know, for what they are worth.
Like, I could say that John wasn't looking for a certain someone. He happened to find a certain someone.
Uh-huh.
What he was saying before, but he got cut off.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
That's what he was saying.
All right, so here's what we're going to do.
Get mad.
Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take a quick break here. We're going to take a quick break here on the Qnow. When we come back, we're going to have more with John Kiehne. We're going to try to do 5 hot seat questions. That's right. I feel like he can knock these out real quick. It won't take a look.
And we can talk a little bit. Pop culture.
Oh, all at the same time, John. You're going to love this. We'll be back on the show after this. AM, KYRO, 102.5, WIBH. Mark Bland sitting here talking to you guys. I got Jenna, I got Jay here, and we've got John Kiehne.
Yay, John.
The congressional candidate going up against Ann Wagner in St. Louis. Oh, look at that. It's not over. It's not over. It just started playing again.
Kick a truck ahead.
It was still there. Look at you. You got the music ready, rock and roll. This guy's going to just dazzle us is what he's trying to do. He's trying
Sammy
to dazzle
just
us.
Thinks that he can do what he wants.
Well, John, do you mind sitting in for a round of our hot seat, as we like to call it?
No, not at all. I'll just play Sammy Hagar tunes that you didn't play.
That's right.
Yeah,
I won't do that to you, but I have played that song.
You're good. You're good. Here's the thing. We've got this thing called the hot seat. It's 5 questions that we rattle off to you, right? We've got they're unique questions. There's no right or wrong answer. Whatever your answer you give is fine. That's your answer. It's really up to you what you want to say to us. And sometimes there's a little discussion, but not too often. So I feel that we can knock this out. Are you ready for the hot seat, sir?
Do you want the long or short?
The short.
Okay.
No, all right.
You did say that, and I did ask.
No, you're fine. You're fine.
Okay.
But you can expound as much as you need. That's up to you.
Okay.
Question number 1, sir. Like I said, no wrong answers. Where do you think Missouri came in on the list of states that poop the most?
Wow.
Oh, yeah, that's a legitimate question because, ladies and gentlemen, I do have.
I mean, let's be honest.
Which
poop
state poops the most?
Poops. Those books are right. They're accurate.
That there's been a study done and published, so we have this information.
We need to know. Waste
it's plants. Got how many per day and everything? Listen, I've got it. Listen.
Kapoof.
Where do you think Missouri came in on the list of states that poop the most,
I wish we
sir?
Could do something with it. North Korea tried.
Can I answer my own way?
Yes, sir. However you'd like.
Well, here's what I have to say. Provel cheese, T-Ravs, Red Hot Riblets.
Okay.
Gooey,
I mean, you are.
And the St. Paul sandwich.
Oh, yeah, 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 yeah. I mean, you've got some heavyweight contenders there.
So I'm going to say that, you know, we're probably pretty high up on the list considering some of our local food favorites, and throw a little Ted Drew's in there for dessert.
Yeah, but just diarrhea.
Well, now, here's the thing. That is his answer. Now, that is a right or wrong answer type thing, but here's the thing. That was his answer, and that's fair. That's fair. The answer of the which state poops the most, they did an actual survey, and they have this worked out. Missouri places 50th out of 50.
Wow, we don't poop at all.
Last.
I knew everyone here was full of.
Because everyone in Jeff City's full of it, yep.
1.1 times per day.
Go poop, people. Jeez.
Versus number one was Michigan.
Okay, what?
2.1 times per day. So an average of 2 times a day to poop.
And then one day you went 3 and then 2. And then
at Michigan. Look, like maybe. I don't know how they average that out. But what do you think about that, John?
Yeah.
Well, I believe that, you know, correlation does not necessarily indicate causation.
That's fair.
However, that's fair. It might suggest that eating sort of Missouri and St. Louis style food, which I guess could
made up cheeses,
would be good for KC, you.
Jams you up.
It jams you up, or is it good for you,
cheese,
right? If I don't poop as much and I do have all those things at my disposal, maybe it doesn't jam me up. Maybe it keeps me loose. You know what
maybe
I'm saying?
Maybe my body just takes everything I put in.
All right.
Doesn't put anything
in. Question number two, John. Do you feel it is weird that nobody ever jokes about Mexico having free health care? Isn't that odd? Do you feel that that's odd?
Well, I'll have to say that in recent years, I haven't been that engaged with the comedy community. So I can't necessarily say nobody jokes about it, but I definitely have known people in my life, only one that I know of, that go to Mexico or some other foreign country to get, you know, health care, either something that cannot access. Actually, no, somebody who just moved to Spain or something to get a treatment that they don't offer, that it's extremely expensive here and it's really cheap in some European countries.
Well,
so
wow. I always found it interesting the fact that Canada is what we always attack when it comes to universal health care.
Yeah.
It's always Canada that gets attacked, right? It's horrible up in Canada. Oh, it's never, down in Mexico, it's terrible down there for that universal health care they got going on.
It's
like, I always find that weird.
Stupid.
I think it's the whole poverty and death thing and, you know, drug cartels that kind of, you know, taint.
Put a hamper on things.
And, you don't think about free health care. You're like, ugh, cartels.
Yeah. Free health care, I'm going to need it if I get shot by a drug lord.
Oh, and they're so awful, those videos.
I am excited to ask John this next question, actually. I'm excited to, because, John, I feel like this is going to be an interesting one to hear you answer. If animals,
wait, have the last two been interesting? That's my question.
Oh, they have been. They have been. They have been. But check this one out. Check this one out. I think this one's going to hit you with some. If animals could talk, which one do you think would be the best conversationalist?
A very good question. Well, I'll tell you what. We have two kitty cats, and I would have to say that I do converse with them. I'm not really sure what they are saying, but I can actually converse with them, but it's just meow, 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 meow.
Right, right.
Which probably means pet me or feed me. But, I don't know. You know, I'm a big fan of the llama. I hate to admit it.
Okay.
You know, llamas are really cool animals, but I've never had I've never engaged a llama in
conversation. Does it look like it would be a good conversationalist? I don't know. I'm not sure.
If they don't spit at you, you know?
They got that to their benefit, right? They could always spit at you because they don't need to like you.
Yeah.
It's fair.
Right.
Question number four, sir. Question number four. If you had the power to instantly know one mystery from history,
easy.
Which one would you choose to find out about? The power to instantly know one mystery from history.
I really like that question. I feel kind of on the spot because I just want to give it a really good answer. You know, I'll say it. I'll have to add my own thing in there. As someone who is, you know, got into politics trying to help kids that have been victims of just horrible stuff, funding has always been an issue to me. And at some point, I started trying to imagine, because within the establishment, it just was nothing. I would try to imagine, if I won the lottery and I had $1 billion, what would I do if I had unlimited resources? So that's like been one of those questions for me. It's like that what if question that would open up my brain to some other possibilities to consider. And in this case, I'm trying to think of what that opens up a whole realm of possibilities. I'm not really big on conspiracies. You know what? I think I would like to know the reality of life after death.
Okay.
Wow.
You want to know the final answer?
Better than mine, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, you know, there are like arguably 4,200 something world religions, right? And so many people have these different versions of what they perceive the afterlife to be or not. And many people predicate their entire lives upon, I'm going to do this because I'm going to heaven or because something, something, something. I'm like, you know, it would be really interesting. Are there ghosts? I mean, I've experienced some kind of weird things in my life regarding, I'm not sure what that was, but, you know, I can't put a label on
it. Would you tell others that reality? If you found out about it, would you be the one? Would you hoard that piece of information, which could be extremely, like, valuable. Like,
right?
One of the most...
start a mega church tomorrow.
This is the question that literally predicates all religion, all everything. Like, it answers the question.
Right?
So it's like, yo, I know the answer for sure. And by the way, if the people, like, the general population in the world... we're told, hey, he definitely does know the answer. It's up to him to tell you all, but he definitely knows the answer.
You know, the question at
that point would be, what would you do? Would you hoard that information?
I can't remember the name of this movie. There was a movie about this guy that was like a quote-unquote Christian warrior, and he was more like, you know, a superhero underground. He didn't have superpowers, but he had to go and, like, you know, do stuff that it was kind of under the radar, doing God's work, so to speak.
Fair enough.
But he never did it. I can't remember the movie. I don't know. It wasn't Transformers. I know that. He did it because he for no personal advancement. It's just he felt the mission, blah, blah, blah. And, you know, I think a lot of stuff that I do is like I cost myself money and time doing a lot of the things that I've been doing the last really 16 years.
Well, not with your mega church. You know what you would need, though, if you had a mega church? You would need like 3 or 4 miracles to hook everyone in, like some weak, far-off prediction that's lame but accurate, and then boom, mega church done.
What I'm saying is, like, I don't know if I don't know if I'd want to tell anybody, just because it could be so devastating. Like, it could be very...
the fact that it gets out could change a lot of things.
Like,
it
Jesus could, yeah, was could, like, hey, I'm the son of God.
They're like, whatoosh! But the other thing is that we're looking at a time when we have just unprecedented access for anyone, almost anyone, if you have broadband access and a smartphone, to information. And we still have a segment of the population that thinks the earth is flat. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
So this kind of stuff, it seems like no matter, and in our country, I'm in politics, we're talking about politics, and all the disinformation, misinformation, just nonsense of a cesspool of just, I would say, just informational garbage that people will buy into, that they'll accept, that they will internalize, would make me wonder if I or anyone truly did have that answer, if anybody would, you know, I'd say there'd be a segment that would believe, there'd be a segment that wouldn't believe, there's a segment that if you told them that they are a human being, they'd, no, I'm not,
hey,
you know?
Just need a few.
You know, it'll be hard.
Well,
listen.
Don't worry about it. You don't have to explain it all out today. There's no way we're going to be able to implement this idea.
Not me think about it though.
But
now
I do love
it.
It's okay. I want that. Listen. Here's what we're trying
that
to
was
do here,
mine.
John.
We're the
trying,
same one.
We're trying to explain to you. We're trying to explain to you one simple thing, John. Okay. And this is why we're having this interview today. Okay. The Qnow is the best political show in St. Louis, Missouri.
That's true.
That's what we're trying to prove to you today.
Facts.
We're trying to explain this to you. Like, we want the people to we want them to know that there are interviewers and people out there that are good at what they do in politics. They're going to bring the best of the best to the table, like yourself. They want the people like you to be heard. And we think that this is our opportunity to razzle and dazzle you just as much as it is your opportunity to razzle and dazzle the whole world out there. And I think that you do have that aspect to you. But I got to ask you this last question. I have to ask you this last hot tea question.
Wait, were you just kind of like trying to butter me up for the last question?
I was trying to butter you up for the last question. I was just saying. All right. Okay. Slow down there. Don't stop short. Okay. Whoa. What are two foods that people never put together? But when you do, oh my goodness, it's delicious, and others 100% should try it. You know you have one. I think, has this answer.
I don't do it as much anymore, but I used to, when I get McDonald's fries especially, I would get mayonnaise and pepper, put that together, and dip my fries in it.
Okay.
It's really good.
Mayonnaise doesn't taste like anything.
Theirs does.
No.
It does to it.
All right.
You know, I could
the
see
one
that.
I got
I could
did.
Doing that. I could see that.
What do you think, Mr. Kiehne?
Man, you know what? Right off the top of my head, all I can think is, I'll be honest, you know, number one, I'm a guitar player.
Yes,
so
sir.
Whenever anybody says you're a liberal, you say, I'm a guitar player. So I defer to that every time. I'm a guitar player. All I can say is, as a guitar player, is that pineapple on pizza is blasphemy.
Okay. Okay.
Those are fighting words. I like pineapple.
Okay.
Oh, so is my wife. You know what else my wife eats? She puts ketchup on her tacos.
No.
Isn't that disgusting?
No, you never put ketchup on your tacos.
Like,
no, you
like Jack in the Box tacos too.
Oh no.
Taco Bell tacos.
No.
When we're out, I'm sorry, I mean to cut you off. When we went to a Mexican restaurant once, I had to ask for ketchup.
Oh.
They don't have ketchup out.
Now that
like
is
why?
Blasphemy.
Yeah. Oh.
No.
She loves it.
No.
He said no. Nah.
All right.
Absolutely not going to
right?
happen.
I mean.
All right. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Kiehne, I want to thank you for being on the Qnow now. We really appreciate you taking the time out of your busy schedule to jump on here with us. He did the hot seat. Let's give it up for him.
Successful hot seat.
Correct.
That was a good one.
Very good.
Congratulations, sir.
I'm curious now, the poop one that we're number 50, right?
Yeah, we are number last. 50, sir. We are last place.
Right. I would be surprised if we weren't 50th in everything. Like
no, that's fair.
On every other metric.
We're 50th
today. Dumb and full of poop.
I know.
But here's the deal. Here's the deal.
Pregnant.
Worker pay.
Here's the deal. Listen, I want to have you come back on. I want to have you come back on. And you know what? I think that we're going to have a really good time next time you come back on the show. I think we're going to have a great time because I want to dive. Like today I wanted people to get to know you a little bit. You know what I'm saying? Because I've been told you've got some great ideas. They need their chance to grow. They need their chance to shine. The sun needs to shine upon these things.
Right on.
And I want to make sure that we have a time to really like sink our teeth into it. You know what I'm saying? Actually, you know what?
Absolutely.
You know what? Listen. I am going to call a quick audible here right now. We're going to take a quick break. When we come back, if you've got the time, Mr. Kiehne, I would love to talk to you a little bit about some of your policy.
Absolutely.
Would that be okay? Can we bring
we
you back on?
We can talk about politics because I was kind of stuck on the other five questions.
Oh,
here.
I know. I was talking about maybe giving you some politics. Unless you want to just come back on some other time. You can too. That's up to you.
I'm here for y'all.
You're here for us?
I'm living the public life.
You're in the world. You're doing it right now. Okay, that's fine, ladies and gentlemen. We are going to take a quick break here on the Qnow now. When we come back, more with Mr. Kiehne, John Kiehne, running for Congress, up against Ann Wagner. We'll be back on the Qnow now right after this. AM, KYRO, WIBH also, if you're listening to us over there. Little Soundgarden. John Kiehne is still with us on the phones. You did make it through, Mr. Kiehne, did you?
I'm a little confused because you said Soundgarden emo, and I don't think those two things go together.
No.
Soundgarden
is not
experts.
Soundgarden, well, is Soundgarden emo? I mean, it is kind of emo. I would say it's
grunge.
A little
grunge.
Of course, it's grunge. I'm Gen X icon. Stop this. That's why they call me the Gen X icon. This is ridiculous, John. If you're not listen, I'm one of the constituents in St. Louis and Missouri. Okay, come on now. You need to know your constituents. Okay, you need to get out here. You need to shake some hands.
He's been out here. I will vouch for him on that.
I know. I'm just saying,
John,
like, he's acting
up.
Like he doesn't know who the Gen X icon is. Okay,
I'm kind of concerned about this whole Soundgarden thing. Yeah.
But that is emo. There was some emo aspect to Soundgarden. Soundgarden was light. No. It was light and weak.
Nope.
Even Bush was heavier than Soundgarden. For sure. Black Hole Sun was fantastic.
Oh, that video.
This
and you're right, it is grunge.
Show, my brother.
No, you're right. It is grunge. It is grunge music. I understand that. It was 1995. I'm playing this stuff. I'm spinning it. 89.5 KCFV. That's right. The wave of the future at Flow Valley. I was banging it out. Black Hole Sun every time. Spin the black circle every time I turned around.
There you go.
That's what I was doing. Now, many a year later, I am on the microphone. I am talking to one Mr. John Kiehne. He is a congressional. He's a congressional candidate going up against Ann Wagner. Correct, sir?
That is correct, sir.
Yep.
And what do we think of said Miss Wagner? What's our personal opinion of our opponent at this moment in history?
I've run for office 3 times in the past in very red districts, and I have always, you know, been acquainted with my opponent. I don't know Ann Wagner from anybody. We don't see her in the district. So nobody else seems to really know her either. But what I will tell you is that I would say as a guitar player, as a parent, as a homeowner, as, you know, a consumer, and as a Democratic candidate, my view on policy is almost diametrically opposed to what she represents in U.S. Congress. And I would say that her votes for Jim Jordan, who is a far-right MAGA guy, and then her
next vote for
Speaker of the House being Mike Johnson, indicates to me her support of Mike Johnson's policy, preferences, initiatives, agenda. And
do we say fascism, sir? Do we say fascism when we say Mike Johnson? Do we say fascism?
Well, you know, people like to throw a lot of isms.
Friendly with it.
So let's not talk isms. And
yeah, let's not talk
isms.
That's fine. That's fair. Let's not talk isms.
Let's say abortion rights, reproductive rights.
Sure.
Da, da, da. And it's not just abortion. It's reproductive rights. We're talking about not only do
take that, J.S. girl.
Take that option away from women, but they also want to take away contraception. They want to, you know, take away sex education. They not only want to prevent an abortion, but they want to preventing an abortion. Or
they don't want you to be a human being, John.
Right?
They don't want you to even be something that represents a physical specimen as a human being. They want to take it away, all of it, everything.
I want to say that I am sympathetic to a voter's opinion about that. I think that there are aspects of that point of view that are somewhat indefensible. But on the other hand, a woman who has to be the person who has to deal with that from point A to point Z, it should be up to her. It's her body. I have 6 kids. I have grandkids. I've, you know, been at the hospital when our kids have been born. And it is, and through the whole process, I've been through the preeclampsia. I've been through all the things that women, not me personally, but I have seen these things. And pregnancy is not an easy thing for a lot of women. And then I, of course, as a foster provider, I and my wife stepped into situations where those parents should not have had those children. So I love the fact that, you know, that these children were in my life, but I hate what was done to them. So if you just take an indefensible stance without taking into consider, I had a judge in one of our cases that her daughter was a crackhead, and this is something that she revealed on the bench, that she had a daughter who was a crackhead who was going to sell her granddaughter, who was an infant, for money to buy crack. And this judge, who was just your regular kind of middle-aged sized woman, went into this crack house, got her grandbaby from the crack dealer's house, and took it and raised that baby. You know, but the fact is that doesn't always happen. That doesn't often happen. So realistically, we have to look at how we take care of our children, how we take care of our mothers. Are we providing child care? We've dealt with the fact that child care is very expensive, and it's kind of hard to access if you have a 0 to, say, 5, you know, like a kindergarten school-age child. All those issues that go into providing for a child. There are no things about policy, whether it's abortion or reproductive rights in general, that is simple. And people try to break this down to a binary, it's right, it's wrong. At the end of the day, it is my opinion that I believe that these decisions should be made between a woman and her physician and her maker, if that's an issue, and, you know, maybe the father, if that's an issue. But it's not the government's job to tell that woman what to do. You know, because the government's not going to be the one that's going to have to deal with it.
I couldn't agree with you more. From the beginning to the end, all of it, everything, like, there's nothing more refreshing to hear than a candidate that understands that there needs to be some onus given to the lady for her own works and worths within the world. Like, I don't understand why it's such a big problem, right?
Because
nuance seems to be
nuance.
Nuance can often be the problem for getting a point across. And you know, if you simplify something down to a basic emotional idea, like, a lot of folks will just key in on that. But there's just so much nuance in almost any kind of policy, in you know, decisions you make in your life. And it could be about your house, your job, or your spouse, or your family, or an illness. You know, most things are just not that simple.
John, let me ask you a quick question here. Media within politics, media and its effect on politics, media and politics in general. Where's your stance on that? How do you feel? How do you view the media in its relation to politics and how politics looks at it?
Well, you know what? I'm a Gen Xer as well. And I came up in a time, I don't know if you remember Ministry and Public Enemy and all those folks. I'd say, you know, back in the 90s, there was a big, you know, New World Order and a lot of socially conscious music that was, and of course Rage Against the Machine and some other bands came out of it as well. But in that day and time, that was pre-broadband internet. That was pre-having, you know, processors, like, I remember getting my first desktop computer that, you know, was basically like, it's like a calculator, you know, by today's standards. You know what I'm saying? And the way that media has gone from a select group of things, and I grew up here, so I'll say this too. When I was a kid, we had 5 channels on our TV growing up in St. Charles. We had 2, 4, 5, 9, and 11. Then we got a TV with a UHF on it. We had channel 30.
Yeah.
So in growing up,
Channel
that
11,
was it.
That
you
was
had always, ABC, CBS, and NBC that were running news. That was your
wrestling
news outlet.
Wrestling at the Chase, remember?
You read the paper.
Yeah.
And on and on and on. Now we have some dude sitting in his mom's basement that has the internet access,
right?
You know, can become an influencer. So I think that the right, number one, for decades, has invested their money and their time and their resources into not only what is essentially Saul Alinsky's, you know, old organizing methods in, you know, grassroots organizing that basically they took from the Democrats and the socialists, to also buying radio stations, putting Rush Limbaugh on the radio, putting Glenn Beck on the radio. They buy radio stations. They put them on satellite radio because they're getting that message out there, which then cable TV came along.
And so they love telling people about it, too. They love telling people about it, too. They love to get that word. Like, remember, Donald Trump, he is perfect at doing this. He doesn't let a good what was it that Churchill said? Never let a good crisis go to waste or whatever it was. That is Donald Trump. And if somebody gets associated with him, bigger or better than he's associated with it, he takes it personally. He's like, oh no. The dead bodies, they literally laying at my feet. feet.
You know, I just say that I would say your average American, who I don't believe the right and left differentiation is so weird to me now, because I don't feel like clean water is a leftist idea. You know?
Right,
I don't
exactly.
Feel like not wanting to
these
get shot
like normal
is
things.
A leftist idea. But these ideals have been very successfully branded and rebranded and over again by these folks who control and dominate media. And as a person who's, say, a regular person to the left, there's so little opportunity to push back. So you have your station, right? You have your show.
Yeah.
And you have 2 hours in which you talk about a broader, you know, variety of points of view on these issues. And, you know, and of course, what state poops the most. But, you know, my point being that there just is not a quote-unquote media outlet for normal people to talk about normal stuff. It is, I guess, on one hand, not compelling so much, you know, because it's just, hey, this happened. You know, it's kind of cool. Rachel Maddow, in my opinion, is an example of someone who's catering to the other side. And I have no problem with Rachel Maddow. What I'm saying is that a commentator that's commenting on news stuff, whether I agree on her or not, as a politician running for office, my thought process is, how do I best represent the needs and wants of the people in my district? And to me, that it has to, we have to unite around common everyday concerns: healthcare, jobs, prices. My wages are definitely not rising at the level of inflation. All these things that people are dealing with every day, but they get sort of superseded by these hot plate cultural issues, be it CRT or something that's, you know, and it is very difficult as someone in politics without a lot of money and without a lot of influence to plug into, to be able to push back against that. And what we're pushing back against, or I'd say our point of view, in my opinion, it's just like, this is kind of regular. This is where regular people are at. You know, this is what regular people are dealing with. CRT, I did 6 candidate forums out in rural Missouri last fall.
Right.
Again, you know, against Republican candidates. Let's say, like, really, really July. So last summer, 6 of them. And there were 5 Republican candidates and me. The Republican candidates, each of which, who, by the way, spent $300,000 on the primary in a state Senate race in rural Missouri, all they're talking about is CRT and trans kids.
Yeah.
And I'm like, I don't know if you drove here, but that is the very last concern of the people in this area, in this community. Like, they don't – CRT, number one, college class for law students, you know, post-grad. Number two, trans kids, they're in Fenton and they're coming to get you. Are you serious? So the Republicans are not bringing an A game.
Right.
They are completely playing into these cultural stereotypes, and then they're playing it up in media day after day after day.
John, we're getting ready to get out of here with you on the show. I know that you probably have a website. Where can people find you to find out more about you and your campaign?
A very good question. Pretty easy. So, number one, you spell my name, Kiehne. So if you look up Kiehne, you're probably going to find me. But I'm at Qnow4Missouri.com, FORMissouri.com. I'm also on social media at Qnow4Missouri. I also have johnkiehne.com that is actually kind of under construction, that will be my daily my kind of daily activity website.
Right.
What I did is, I've run for state legislative seats a couple times, and I just fired up a new one with kind of a fresh you know, a fresh approach, or I'd say just, you know, not 6 years past of social media stuff, to just focus on this race and what we're trying to do in the second congressional.
All right. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I want to thank John Kiehne, congressional candidate going up against Ann Wagner, for joining us today on the show. Thank you so much, Mr. Kiehne. We really do appreciate it.
Right on. Thank you. Have me back, man. It was good talking to y'all.
All right. Great to talk to
Thanks,
you,
John.
Too, sir.
Thanks.
Oh, sorry about that. We'll be right back on the queue now, right after this.
Honey. This mic is too high. Drop it. Drop it. Drop it.
Yeah. 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 I just been living life feed a bankroll. How the saying go? Got it.
1280 AM KYRO. Raincoat, pair of boots and a dangle. Nick D, bankroll. I might pull up in a stagecoach. We got Jenna Roberson here.
Hello.
Now coming out the wood. We got Jason Cole.
All right.
That's you.
It is me.
And myself, Mark Bland. We want to thank John Kiehne for coming on here, candidate for Congress.
Yeah,
not, I was going to say Senate. That. I was going to say Senate, but Congress.
Congress.
Maybe next time it is Senate. We don't know. We never know.
Yeah.
We don't know what's going to go on in this world.
Yeah,
ladies and gentlemen.
Terms and then get rid of Holly.
One thing that we are going to do is we are going to do this tournament of pop culture to finish this show off. We have our second round. That's our second week of 4 weeks of biggest jerks in television and movie history. That's right.
Yeah.
So all coming right. up in our first matchup, we have one Biff Tannen of Back to the Future. Oh, a perennial jerk. A perennial jerkwad, if ever there was to be one. They're going to be going up against Lydia Tarr from Tarr, a television show from England. But at the same point, I feel like that this is an easy win for Biff Tannen. How is Biff Tannen not going to beat out Lydia Tarr? Like, I'm not even trying to be funny or anything like that. It's
Back to the Future 1 and 2 took me from 12 to 16. I mean,
it was by far.
I hated Biff Tannen.
Remember who Biff Tannen was based on?
Listen, but here's the funny thing:
if you ask
Gen X people about what movies are Generation X, like if you were to like that, Back to the Future by far is by in my opinion like the best movie of Generation X history. Like it's the best overall movie, top to bottom, like acting, everything, like the music,
story.
The soundtrack, the story, everything. It's perfect. It's great. A lot of people though, they're not going to mention Back to the Future. I hate to say that. They're going to bring up Goonies and they're going to bring up other like more Gen X.
The Breakfast Club.
Like any Ferris Bueller. Yeah. Any Ferris Bueller.
The Never Ending Story.
Ferris Bueller.
There you go.
They're in that group, but they're not.
But Back to the Future is a better movie overall than every single one of those. Back to the Future, but here's the problem. Back to the Future is what you want in a movie for a summer blockbuster and good enough to win the Academy Award.
Right.
Even though it didn't, still good enough to win the Academy Award.
It teases a second one at the end. How great is that?
Next round, Ramona Singer of The Real Housewives of New York. She is quite the individual.
She's something.
Here's the thing. This is something that we're going to have to bring to the table here in a second. Versus Jim Halpert of The Office. Now, let me bring this out real quick. This might be a closer matchup than people think because... Whereas Jim Halpert is a character on the show The Office that's written to be a jerk, to be this way towards Dwight and a lot of other people, but that's why Jim is. But he's slick about it. He's smooth.
I guess he's a prankster.
I like Jim because he's slick about it. Right?
Yeah.
He's the smarmy guy who would steal your girlfriend from you, and that's basically what kind of happens anyway because of the Office romance with him and Pam.
Pam, yeah.
So. Ramona, though, is a real person. That's a real television show. These are real human beings, and this is how she really is in real life. That kind of adds an element of surprise and that chaoticness, a little bit more of a loose cannon aspect to her, whereas Jim's a little bit more chambered with the way he goes about things. I don't know, man. If I had to, like, my druthers, it's probably Jim Halpert. Jim Halpert. I'm not against Ramona Singer, and I do think she's a worthy opponent for Jim, but I got to go Jim Halpert.
Is Jim a better jerk character than her actual real life.
Oh, I don't think I don't
like,
know.
It's so much better.
No, it's just a different.
So real.
It's a different realism. Yeah. It's a different vibe. Right.
I feel like I could like him as a jerk. Her, just like there's something about it just makes you want to kind of like slap her in the face.
And yeah, to be the best jerk, I feel that there has to be a lovable aspect to you. There has to be something like when Shooter McGavin won the first week. You know what I'm saying? All to right. make it into the championship, there is something lovable about Shooter McGavin. Like, or there is this love to him.
Like Bill Murray in Kingpin.
All right.
Oh, yeah.
Right?
Loved him in that.
Jim Halpert or Ramona Singer?
Ramona.
Ramona for me.
I don't know who Ramona is, so I'm forced to go with Jim.
And I'm going
to
go Jim, too. So Jim Halpert is moving on. Next up is Ferris Bueller of One Ferris Bueller's Day Off.
He's kind of like a gym jerk.
Yeah.
Versus Steph McKee of Pretty in Pink. We knew Steph. Steph was that jockish kind of guy.
Was that James Spader?
Yeah.
Yeah. Bigger jerk than Ferris. Ferris is a cool dude.
Yeah, but see, that's the thing. Like, there's a lovable
cool
aspect to that.
Wait.
When he was a jerk to Cam, like, Cam was, like, dead to rights on that. Like, he was right. Like, you did this, and you did this, and you always act this way, and there's no reason for you to do that. And so, like, you know, he's a lovable jerk, but he definitely has his moments where he, like, will break that heart. And let's be honest, if there is one friend outside of maybe Corey Feldman in Goonies as Mouth, right?
Big jerky
friend. It's got to be Cam and Ferris Bueller. Like, that's the other friend that most Gen Xers would rock with and would be cool. Would be like, yeah, I'll hang out with Cam. Like, Cam's the dude. Like,
yeah,
I'm
cool. James Spader's character is more of a, like, sociopath.
He's an a-hole.
He is just an a-hole.
He's more creepy bad. Yeah.
So where are you going to go?
Okay, I feel like I'm not understanding the criteria. When you say bigger jerk, do you mean one that we like or one that we... Because I'm picking the one I think it's an actual bigger jerk.
Wait, just make it up as
so, I don't think it has to be so much physically the biggest jerk. I think there can be other aspects that make him the best or overall, you know, biggest jerk in that regard.
Okay, if we're sticking with the credit.
I'm going to go with Steph McKee the two.
I would have to say, I'm judging my mind on who I'd want to hit, and I'd want to hit him.
Yeah, Steph McKee. Yeah.
I would have went with him too because Ferris just doesn't strike me as the jerk I'm thinking of. He's just kind of like, he's like that nerdy kid that went away to college and then came back.
Interesting,
and
because Ferris is like
he's
a pretty
now, but he's kind of a dick about
well-known and respected jerk. But at the same point, like, I feel like the Steph McKee is a little bit more low-key and a little bit more on the
he's
cruddy
more like,
side.
Like,
he was an awesome character.
Let's see what we get here. Yeah. Okay, do you guys watch Succession at all?
No.
I don't. I know the character.
I know Stewie Hosseini. Stewie is one of the characters, very big jerk, but he's going up against Loki. From the MCU, from the Marvel Cinematic Universe.
Loki's evil.
Loki is one of those people that it was never the point of the main movies was the relationship between Thor and Loki and why there was this feeling
so
that
bad.
Loki was a bad dude. But, you know, there's always going to be bright sides to bad people, even when they're off on their own by themselves. Well, there are moments that they will have that if we saw them in those moments, we might look at them in a different light. Like, I understand Loki.
Where you kind of
understand. But Loki's a jerk
Loki's
who
so
uses
mad.
Magic to be a jerk, and he also will impersonate you. And I feel like that is like over the top. Like, he will change into you as a person to lie to somebody else. And that's a much bigger jerk move. So I've got to go Loki.
I'd still have a beer with Amako with the other one that I don't
You're
know.
Going with Stewie.
By default, I would never watch the show.
I'm also going to go with Loki.
All right. Loki is moving on
like,
in this.
He's like a violent. A violent Ferris Bueller.
Now, we have another one of the Ramona Singer type situations here where we have Spencer Pratt from The Hills.
Oh,
now,
that guy's
a much younger Jenna.
That guy's on a different list.
A much younger Jenna might have watched an episode or two or had a friend who talked about it a lot.
That's like my little sister.
He's more of a D-bag than a jerk.
Right, but he's going up against Kenny Powers of Eastbound and Down.
I just started watching that show.
Was it because we told you to?
Yes, we just got into it. Oh, it is so good.
Oh, Kenny Powers. First off, I'm sorry, Spencer. I know you're, once again, you're a real person, but Kenny.
You want to be on this list so bad.
Kenny Powers is the man.
Kenny.
Kenny's a jerk, though, of the ultimate variety. Like, he is, dude, like, Kenny could be a dark horse, bro. I'm just being honest. You got 4 weeks of this, but Kenny could be a dark horse. Next up, somebody who Kenny could possibly be going against, could be tough matchup here. Ron Burgundy of Anchorman. An ultimate jerk, like rich mahogany. Like the type of like
leather-bound books.
But even better, he's rich that mahogany. Guy who has the job that makes him have the ego that feels like he's a superstar when he's really a low guy on the totem pole type thing. And that's what really is. He's going to be going up against one half of our favorite duo in the Matt Damon and
Ben Affleck,
Fred O'Bannon of Dazed and Confused. That's your just legitimate Spencer Pratt type jerk. That's more of your just straightforward, I want to be a jerk for the sake of being a jerk. Whereas Ron, but then again, Ron is being a jerk because his ego is driving him like that.
Yeah, he can't handle it. But you know what? In the end, they both kind of come around a little bit
Ron Burgundy, the same way I like Kenny Powers. Yeah. Like, I kind of like him on the backside.
Well, the other guys love hanging out with Ron.
I think I got to go Ron Burgundy.
I got to go Ron Burgundy.
You're right.
Yeah, I think you got to go Ron.
I think O'Bannon would beat his wife.
He's one of those guys that's got some anger.
Yeah.
Something happened to him.
Next up, we have The Grinch from How the Grinch Stole Christmas.
Oh, poor guy.
Against Vegeta from Dragon Ball Z. Now, this is actually an interesting matchup. Now, you guys might not be familiar with Dragon Ball, and that's okay.
I am not.
I was making fun of it at one point, and then I watched a couple episodes of something, and somebody told me you should really check out Dragon Ball Z if you like that. And I checked out a couple episodes. Not a horrible show. Vegeta is quite the jerk, quite the a-hole. I don't know if he handles against the Grinch. The Grinch literally stole Christmas. Like, he stole a holiday, the lights.
Right?
He had a dog that's lovable but helped him. Like, right. The Grinch. Like and his heart, dog. It did grow. But and once again, we love them in the end for who they are.
Right, he comes around.
But because the beauty of a great jerk, I think,
but the other one
is they have that moment, kind of like Ferris Bueller, they have that moment of clarity that they know that they're the jerk. Even in Breakfast Club, even with the guy that Judd Nelson plays.
Yeah.
Like, he has that moment of clarity when he realizes, oh, they're not so different just because of this. You know what I'm saying? The famous lipstick moment or whatever.
Good job, Claire.
So I'm going to go the Grinch over Vegeta.
By default, I'll go with the Grinch
as well.
I'm also
going to go with the Grinch because I don't know what a Vegeta is. I think you're saying like a silly word.
That's
for
fair.
Yeah,
that's
a fair. Vagina.
It sounds like an age.
The last one could. The last one could be interesting depending on how well you know these characters. But we have Selena Meyer of Veep. If you watch the show,
anti-hero.
Definitely an anti-hero. Riley Freeman of the Boondocks, which is a very entertaining show.
Watch that in forever.
I would go Selena Meyer.
I've read that more than anything.
But I would go Selena Meyer. Me, personally. I feel that she just gets ahead. I got to go Selena Meyer. She at least uses the power to go for, the jerk. I feel like an important criteria of the jerk style of things is that it has to move the character or the story forward in some valuable fashion.
Well, and like she knows she's a jerk. She like literally tries to hide it.
Like the beauty of Biff Tannen, which we'll talk about Biff here in a little bit, is the fact that Biff, and he's going to be in the next round. He starts off the next round. He's going to be going up against Jim Halpert. But what I will say before we hit break about Biff Tannen is Biff, even though he is like the bad guy in someone else's story, the ability to usurp and find the dad connection and still find inadvertently like runs into these two aspects.
Yeah.
And then they end up being like roommates technically. And it's just like, wow, you guys are both kind of the same no matter what. Like you are your dad's child. Like he just needed to learn how to be who he was. Like that's all it needed.
Like Biff is evil and then weak. In two different parallel lives.
Exactly.
Because of the space-time
continuum. And that's the other thing. Biff goes to other sections of time to be a complete jerk. Like, he is not just in one part. He's in multiple parts of time.
He's changed himself multiple different ways.
And it's his great-great-grandfather or whatever who's running, like, the evil Western game. The problem. It's like the Biff Tannen aspect of this.
It's dedication to your craft.
All right,
ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take a quick break here on the Qnow. Now, when we come back, we are going to finish off this tournament of pop culture. Week two, biggest jerk in television movie history. We will be back on the Qnow now after this. Well, 80 a.m., KYRO. The Qnow, Jenna Roberson, Mark Bland, and Jason Kull.
I want to skateboard to school.
Off the back of a truck?
Off the back of vehicles.
There were so many people that tried that. After that movie Back to the Future came out, there were so many people that tried to skateboard off the back edges of cars and trucks. And you saw it everywhere.
And they didn't remove it.
It's the Gen X Tide Pod Challenge.
Remember the movie The Program?
It really was. Remember the movie The Program?
They were laying in the middle of the
highway. And they took it out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they had to because people started doing it and there was kids that got killed. Yeah,
and they took it out.
All right, ladies and gentlemen.
They didn't care about us back then.
We moved on to the next round of our Tournament of Pop Culture for week two. Biggest television or movie jerk character in history. I've said that a million different ways. It's got to be one of them.
It's fine.
We have Biff Tannen from Back to the Future going up against Jim Halpert of The Office, a perennial television powerhouse.
Jim's too nice, though. If I'm not Dwight, I like Jim's pretty cool.
I like Jim's. But see, that's the thing. Like, I like Jim's jerk better than I like Biff's jerk. See, and that's where Jenna's argument. No, but that's where Jenna's argument comes in of which criteria to base it off of. Is it biggest a-hole, which is more Biff, or a big, like,
smarmy guy.
Smarmy, kind of like
a
jerk with redeeming qualities that, like, is just like out for blood. He's like smart, too smart for their own good.
Like, he hates the people you hate.
Smart jerk. This kind of becomes smart jerk versus dumb jerk.
Yeah.
That's what it becomes. Smart jerk versus dumb jerk.
Powerful, dangerous.
Dumb and powerful is extremely dangerous and a much bigger jerk overall in life. Like, Biff is kind of like Trump. Biff kind of is like Trump.
He was modeled after.
Daddy issues. Sounds about right.
All right. Jay, where are you going?
I got to go Biff just because Jim has too many redeeming qualities to be a big jerk.
What about you?
I would go with Biff, too.
You're going with Biff. Yeah. Biff moves on. I was going to go Biff also, so that was a clean sweep.
We win.
Steph McKee is taking on one Loki.
Oh,
I'm going to...
Loki's way more violent.
Yeah, Loki's way more violent. Steph's a pretty big jerk. Like, the things that he does. But Loki, also does the same type of things like Steph does. Like, he has his moments where he just goes full Steph. I don't know. I think I'm going to go Loki.
Loki comes back, though, a little bit.
For the same reasons I chose Biff, I'm going to go with Steph.
Okay.
Like the a-hole.
The a-hole aspect. Yes. Yeah, I feel like Loki's a bigger a-hole than Steph. That's my personal opinion.
But he's got
powers.
That's unfair.
Yeah, but see, because of that,
but you can choose to do more with your powers than you
worse
do.
A-hole.
Right, so he could do far worse than he's chosen to.
No, you're right, but he already's done a lot. Like,
he tried,
why am
though
I defending Loki so hard right now?
He tried.
He's not that bad, guys.
I'm going Loki. She's going Steph. Jay, it's up to you.
I'm
going to
go Loki.
All right, Loki's moving on.
He's so mean.
All right.
Fine.
So mean.
Kenny Powers People don't understand how good that character is. They really don't. Like, until you watch, like, Righteous Gemstones and shows like that and see how good Danny McBride is at acting and just being
fantastic.
Like, he's fantastic. And the whole crew, the whole first season, especially first season of that show, brilliantly done. Just fantastic. I love that show. That show, I have to go back and start watching it again. Kenny Powers is going up against Ron Burgundy.
I'm just gonna go Kenny Powers.
We're getting similar in our stylings. Man, you know, Ron, those can be, they can both be really funny though. That's the problem. And Kenny Powers also gets you a little Will Ferrell in it at one point because of Ashley, whatever it is, he plays the car dealer owner.
Oh yes, that's right.
Big blonde
Ashley
hair.
Simpson.
I paid you closer $25. $25. You'd be out there and you throw.
You'd be out there and you throw.
And he did have some impressive dance moves. Woo! Woo! When he was chaperoning the dance.
Woo! 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 That's all he kept doing. He kept going, woo. Kenny Powers or Ron, though. Kenny does it out of blindness of stupidity. Ron does it out of pure ego. That you can almost see that he almost wields it at a certain point in a weaponized
Kenny
weather. Kenny doesn't know better, but that might be what like Biff makes
hit.
It. That might make him more like Biff. Like he's like, like he's just like
his,
off.
His instinct is just to be mean and cruel.
Yeah.
I'm going to go Kenny Powers also.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah. I got to go Kenny Powers.
I got one.
Ron redeems a little too much. Like, Loki, I can accept his redemption because he was so evil and did so much destruction.
All right.
It's a low bar.
Yeah. You know, it's like, oh, wow, you really had a lot to atone for. Congratulations.
Up next, we have the Grinch. Stole Christmas. I'm amazed they didn't try to turn it into stole Halloween, stole 4th of July, stole the Easter. Like, steal all the different holidays. Yeah. Let the Grinch be that person.
Stop picking on Christians.
And all they have to do is put a different, like, you know, egg floral thing in his hair, you know, like he carries Easter baskets around at Easter time. Like, you know, just go a little wild with it. Steal St. Patrick's Day, just goes and beats up. Like, that's the snuff film. That's the snuff film that we eventually make for the underground internet, which is just somebody dressed like the Grinch beating the crap out of St. Patrick for no reason.
Give me
just stick to here.
Just running through and knocking the Guinness out of people's hands and running off.
Grinch is going up against Selena Meyer. Man, Selena is really kind of a B at times.
That's why I'm going to go with her.
I don't know, man. Yeah.
You guys are looking for redemption here. I'm looking for commitment to craft.
That's fair. Like, it's just a tough matchup. The Grinch has got so many nostalgic aspects in my heart.
Right. Multiple different
that
reasons.
Like when I was a little kid, remember like it was Frosty or whenever it was any of the Christmas classics, the Peanuts, Rudolph, that was CBS on like a Thursday night at 7 o'clock, and you had to be there, the TV, ready to go, or else
watch it
you
later.
Were done. There was no watching it later.
Didn't re-watch
a lot of people
it.
Didn't have VCRs at the time, and The Grinch was one of those shows. Like, it would be on a double feature. It would be like the Peanuts and then the Grinch, or like Rudolph and then Frosty, like... The Grinch really holds that nostalgic park. I gotta go to Grinch. I gotta go to the Grinch.
Yeah, I think you might be right.
You think I might be right? You think you're gonna go to the Grinch?
Well, you know,
she said Selena.
I did.
The Grinch is kind of like Batman. There's been so many different variations. You could have your favorite. Some people like the Carrie. Some people like the new animated.
What's
one.
The best Grinch, guys?
There's only one Batman, and it was Michael Keaton. This
what
is not a
well,
debate.
But there's people
you know,
that have
that.
Their favorites.
Let's do that. What's the best Grinch?
I'm always partial to live action.
I like
Jim Carrey's, but I think between the animated ones, I like the new one with Benedict Cumberbatch.
I'm going to say that I feel I'm going to go classic, the old school.
The old school?
Okay. I'm going to go, what's his name? Earl Darth Vader.
The mean one.
Oh, or James Earl Jones.
Oh, no, but was it James Earl Jones who did that voice?
Yes.
Well,
he did Vader. I don't know.
No, he did Vader. Yeah, I don't know. All right, I'm going to Grinch. Where are you going? Jay?
Grinch.
You're going to Grinch. Okay, the Grinch moves on. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are down to the final four of this bracket. I call it the Hill Valley High Bracket. Right?
Yeah.
The Hill Valley High Bracket.
That's a real school. It's not called Hill Valley, but right there in L.A.
I feel like the town that they go back to in Back to the Future was just the town you grew up in Idaho.
Iowa.
I'm sorry. Iowa, not Idaho.
Yeah.
I feel like it was just that town. Like, it was just that town. Like, that's where you did. Biff Tannen up against one of the main culprits to why Thanos was successful with the snap. Loki. What a jerk. Took people's loved ones away from him. You steal Christmas, fine.
Yeah,
you steal everyone's entire lives away from them. Like,
you know,
sometimes you left the wife but took the kid. Sometimes you left the kid but took both parents. Like, what?
I forgot about Loki's involvement in getting Thanos here. Wow.
I binged watched all those movies during COVID, and so I'm a little old on them, but I forgot about that part.
The coolest feature that they have on Disney Plus is the chronological Star Wars Marvel. That's just the coolest thing.
Oh, Star Wars.
And Marvel?
Marvel. And watch them both chronologically.
That's pretty cool.
Oh, they do that now? I had to look it up and find it.
Why would you want to watch them chronologically when Winter Soldier is the only thing you really need to watch? And that's about it.
There's a lot of good ones in there.
Biff or Loki?
Loki.
I'll go Biff.
Oh.
You know,
Loki, I understand Loki's terrible, but Biff is like that classic high school jerk.
But not to ruin it for anybody, but you know what? If you've seen season one of Loki, everyone knows Loki redeems himself. He tries to save the world, tries to save the existence.
Right.
So I have to go Biff.
Okay.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, Biff moves on to the championship. Will he be going against Kenny Powers or the Grinch? Bigger jerk?
You know, now that I think about it, what the Grinch did is more of a gag.
Kenny's a bigger
jerk. Really
a
jerk thing, because he kind of took it and then was like,
okay.
Just kidding.
You can have it.
But the things he does, just the things Kenny does to Stevie alone. Like.
So, yeah, I think you're right.
I mean, even though Kenny has his moments of redemption, too, with Stevie,
but
Kenny's was just like more personally, like Kenny just didn't know better, and he was told multiple times by his ex that he was this jerk, that he was being this way, like the reason she left him in the first place, and this, that, and like everybody keeps telling Kenny directly to his face, you're a jerk. You're being a jerk. I gotta go Kenny Powers. I gotta go Kenny Powers. What about you, Jenna?
I concur on Kenny.
Okay, yes. Kenny is in the finals. So, ladies and gentlemen, our finals for this bracket, week two, Biff Tannen or Kenny Powers? That's a tough matchup. I've got, like, what happens if you give Biff? Well, I kind of get both of those. Biff with a bunch of money is in Back to the Future Part 2. And
terrible.
Kenny is a jerk with a bunch of money who doesn't know any better. They both were rich. They both acted like jerks. And they kind of handled their lives the same way, right? You know, he was all alone. Like, nobody cared about him. But he was rich because he had his money. And he's at his high-rise apartment. That's what Biff had. Kenny, on the other hand, he, like, loses his life. But he was, like, a World Series champion. And he was, like, the MVP. And then his life just takes a downward spiral. And he's throwing balls at people and stuff.
People like Kenny Powers. People are afraid of Biff Tannen. So it's different.
I would say
that makes Biff more of a jerk.
I think Biff is the physically bigger jerk between these two.
Because we see different variations. Like, when you see Kenny as not a jerk, he's nice, but when Biff's not a jerk, he's actually like a pushover. So
right.
It means, like, actual Biff has to, like, atone for that and be even more jerkier. That's a real
thing. that's a real wormhole way of trying to get to the point.
Super Freudian over here.
Yeah, this is
stuff.
Really weird. It's over the top. I'm gonna go Biff Tannen.
I think so too.
I think so as well.
All right,
12-year-old Jason wins.
Yeah, that's right. Well, I feel
redemption
like
redemption for you.
Remember,
I knew I was right.
Listen. One, and you're not wrong. I mean, it's 1985 when that comes out. I'm not.
Yeah.
I'm 9 years old. I'm right on the edge
right
of hitting them double digits. So, listen. I argued with the Grinch, I think, also holds true for Biff and Back to the Future. There is a nostalgic piece to these characters. And if that nostalgia is to hold and have hold true, you have to, like, make sure that they're like Kenny Powers got deep. That holds true to his, like, mystique in my world. Yeah. Do you see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, I feel that Biff definitely is a bigger jerk. He's going to make it to the Final Four, obviously, of the tournament. We are going to see who is the biggest jerk in all of television and movie history. Man, guys, it's about time to get out of here. Most hated character of TV of all time. 178,000 people voted on this.
Wow. That's I like it.
Who do you think's number one?
Someone on a soap all opera. Time. Stefano DeMiro.
You are on this Days of Our Lives thing.
No, DeMiro. No, not Stefano DeMiro.
This could span so far, but my immediate thought when I think of biggest jerk is Joffrey from Game of Thrones.
Okay, and what about you? What you got?
Other guy.
Blair from that one stupid show.
Gossip Girl?
No.
Blair from The Facts of Life?
Yeah. Everyone hates her, right?
Maybe she'll be in our jerk competition.
Yeah, she was pretty snobby.
Or Daphne, Scooby-Doo.
It could be Daphne. It could be a lot of different people, right? But I will tell you guys
Scooby
this.
Off on, she'd be alone with Fred.
I know.
The individual whose number one is Joffrey Baratheon of Game of Thrones.
I got one. Yay.
Being all cool and stuff.
Ramsay Bolton of Game of Thrones was number two. Well,
these are murderers.
Hold on. Skyler White from The Wife, Skyler White from Breaking Bad.
Yeah, she was awful.
Yeah, she's number three. Number four is Livia Soprano, then Janice Soprano. Then Cersei Lannister comes in at number seven. Lori Grimes from The Walking Dead.
Yeah, she was
Rick
terrible.
Grimes' wife.
I was so happy when she died.
Yeah, right.
But the governor comes in at number 11 on The Walking Dead, and I completely forgot. But you know what blew my mind? Number nine on this list? Caillou. Yeah, Caillou. That's how bad people hate Caillou.
Binge hating.
He's a TV character, ladies and gentlemen. Well, that's going to do it for us on this episode of the Qnow. I want to thank Jenna Roberson for being here.
Yes, thank you.
We want to thank our friend Jason Cole for being here. We also want to thank John Kiehne for being here. He is a congressional candidate, and we want you to vote for John Kiehne if you get a chance. And that's going to do it for us here on this episode of the Qnow. We will see you guys next time on the show. No time for spreading rumors.